Hello from the Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. I'm Sarah Smith, Senior Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I want to thank all of you for joining us for today's webinar, Compliance, Ethics, and Change Management in Today's Business Environments, presented by Sandra Daussin, College Class of 1986. Before we get started, I'd like to share just a few webinar tips and reminders. First, this webinar is being recorded and it will be made available to all registrants on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel within 48 hours of today's broadcast. You'll receive the link to the webinar recording in a webinar follow-up email, which will also contain a post-webinar survey for you to take, information on upcoming webinars, and more ways to stay connected with Georgetown Alumni Career Services. Sandy will take your questions at the end of her webinar, and we encourage you to send in questions and comments as you have them throughout her presentation. To submit your questions and comments, please just use the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel as well. Without further ado, I'm pleased to introduce Sandy Daussin. She's the president and owner of Regulatory Partners Incorporated in Apex, North Carolina. RPI consults with industry clients to help them achieve agrochemical product registrations and genetically engineered crop approvals. Ms. Daussin holds a BS in chemistry from Georgetown and has more than 20 years of work experience with regulated crop protection products. She's currently pursuing her JD at North Carolina's Central University School of Law in their evening program. Sandy, I'm thrilled to turn things over to you to introduce yourself a bit further and to get our presentation started today.
Okay, well, thanks everybody for joining. As Sarah said, I'm a Georgetown alum, so I appreciate the opportunity to work with the Alumni Career Services to present this webinar. So a little bit about my background might give you a little bit more about my background might give you a reason why I'm interested in this and why I have something to say on this topic. So let's take a look first at the landscape. Back in the 50s, 60s, the industry that I work in, agrochemicals, was largely unregulated. The work that was done to support the safety of the registrations was done by labs that were not, there was no oversight or very little. And in the late 70s, there was a scandal at one of the labs, IBT laboratories, that conducted toxicology testing. That scandal triggered the GLPs, which are the good laboratory practice standards. And that those regulations were the basis of most of my career. So that scandal began a series of regulations. The next scandal was a Craven Laboratories, which also triggered some further GLP regulations. So just to get an idea of who's on the call, Sarah and I have worked together to have a poll. Sarah, could you send that out so we could see, I don't want to over-explain something, the poll questions to the audience?
Yep, so the first one I'm gonna send out to everybody is, do you work in a regulated industry? So if you can just take a couple of seconds to submit your answers, just a quick yes or no, just to give us a sense of who we have on the line, that would be great. I'll leave this open for a couple more seconds. Alrighty, let's take a look. So Sandy, it looks like 73% of the folks we have on the line do work in a regulated industry and 27% do not.
Okay.
And then should I go ahead and do the next poll too, the compliance or quality one as well?
Yes.
Alrighty, so another poll for y'all. So do you work in compliance or quality? So let us know if you work in one of those fields. And again, just leaving this open for a couple more seconds too. Alrighty, it looks like a bit more of an even split here, Sandy. So 43% of folks said yes, 57% said no. And our last kind of introductory poll, should I go ahead and ask this one too, Sandy?
Yeah, go ahead.
Great. So this one is, has your company recently within the past 1 or 2 years undergone a change in management, ownership, or business strategy? And again, just leaving this open for a couple more seconds here. And then we'll go ahead and take a look and see. So it looks like 44% of the folks on the line have undergone that change recently, and 56% have not. Awesome. Thank you guys so much for submitting your answers. That's really great to give us a sense of who we have on today's webinar.
Okay. Yes, thank you. That helps. And it will be interesting to hear what you have to say at the end of the webinar for those who have not undergone a change. Anyway, around this, my interest in this area, the regulatory, the regulations came about because of the scandal in the labs in the early 1980s. The next like major scandal had nothing to do with safety data. This was Enron, which was a financial auditing scandal. That one triggered the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002. I'm sure most people are aware of that. That was very largest bankruptcy financial collapse to date at that time in US history. So it was in the news constantly. The kind of relaxed a little bit on the regulations in the areas of the financial real estate area, and that triggered the financial crisis of the late 2000s. And then we got the Dodd-Frank Act, which is in the long name of that is Dodd-Frank Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act. So that one was to in response to this major collapse in the financial industry in the late 2000s. As a result of the Dodd-Frank Act, the U.S. Securities Exchange Commission opened up this whistleblowing program in 2012, which gives us a little bit more insight into what's going on in our business environment. Because of that program, we can see now reports of fraud, and it is pretty clear that fraud in business environments is a reality today. In 2018 fiscal year, the U.S. Securities Exchange Commission whistleblowing program had a banner year. There was more payouts that year than in all the years combined. There were 5,282 tips. That's a lot of tips of fraud. Which was up 76% from when the program began in 2012. So it seems like just looking at that there is a trend that this is not going away. I don't know if it's a trend or if we're just getting more information, but this is a reality of our business environment. So the question is, why? Why is this happening? Don't companies have internal control systems? I know when I worked for a large company, we had to sign our compliance and ethics every year. You had to retrain. This is a very normal part of business today. You're trained in compliance and ethics. And ironically, Enron had a almost exemplary code of conduct that they had their employees sign. If you look at the language here, they required their employees to be moral and honest, and it was essential that they fully comply. This was July 2000, and it was just the next year when this scandal happened. So why didn't this work? Why, you would think that would be enough. So that's what we're gonna talk about today. What is the fraud? What is fraud? What are the consequences of fraud? And when are businesses most vulnerable? Once fraud starts, can it be stopped? And for preventive measures, we're going to look at the role of change management and some common pitfalls, and the role of business ethics in all of this. So just a plain, straightforward definition of fraud. This comes from the Oxford Online Dictionary. It is a wrongful or criminal deception intended to result in financial or personal gain. So it's not just stealing. It involves deception for the purpose of gain. So fraud is a violation of both laws and ethics. So ethics and laws are not the same thing. Ethics is derived from the word ethos, which means habit, character, or custom. But both laws and ethics provide guidance for peaceful living between people. Ethics are moral principles that concern how a person relates to the outside world. It's not the philosophy of what is the meaning of life looking inward. It's how we relate to each other. You are free to have to follow ethical standards or not. This is a personal choice. Then they are usually expressed in the affirmative. Do this, be a good neighbor, share. Ethics set a gold standard of behavior. Laws, on the other hand, are enforced by societal institutions. You can go to jail as a punishment. They are based on ethics, but they are not ethics. They're usually expressed, or not usually, they are often expressed as the negative. Don't steal, don't thieve. They set the lowest standard that society will tolerate. So, So why do good people make unethical choices? So this is a little bit tricky. We have a, oftentimes people, you know, you look at it in the abstract and you think, well, of course, you're always gonna choose right and wrong. Well, ethical dilemmas are not that straightforward. So I had, just to demonstrate this, put a couple of ethical dilemmas together for people to look at. And I'm gonna go ahead and show them on my screen. And then we're gonna take a poll of what you would do in these circumstances. So I'll read it out loud. Can everybody see this?
Zoom in just a little bit, Sandy. It's a little hard to read.
All right, I will zoom in.
Yeah, that's great.
All right. So this first one is, you are an administrative assistant at a large office. One of your tasks is to make travel arrangements and file expense reports. You notice that one of the younger staff members has been padding her expense report. And the questions for this dilemma are, do you blow the whistle and would you change your answer if the staff member was the senior manager? So let's, Sarah, if you wouldn't mind putting out those polls and we could see the answer.
Sure thing. So I'm going to put up the question, do you blow the whistle? So this is in response to Sandy's scenario. And let's just see responses. I'll leave this open for a couple more seconds. Close this. So probably unsurprisingly, the results, 92% of folks said they would blow the whistle, 8% said they would not. Great, thank you. And then following up to that question, the second part of this question is, would your answer change if the staff member was a senior manager? So yes, no, or not applicable. Maybe you are the senior manager, maybe, you know, that doesn't matter in your current situation, so just let us know. I will leave this open for just a second longer. All right, so 33% of folks said yes, their answer would change, and 67% said no, their answer would not change if the person was a senior manager. Awesome, thank you.
Okay, yeah, so in this case, I mean, it's a little difficult on webinar, we can't really discuss it, but I'll just throw out a few ideas that I had on this scenario. Stealing is, you know, in the abstract is always wrong, but blowing the whistle for something that is minor may cause you a lot of difficulty with your employer if they don't want to hear you complaining. If it was only $5, you know, so what? Never going to affect the bottom line. On the other hand, you know, it's a slippery slope. Is it $5 every week? I mean, how is this, you know, some facts and circumstances around that might make it go a little bit more one way or the other way, depending on your personal gold standards, your personal ethics. But it sounds like most people on the call are just reading it flat, what the facts are, would go ahead and turn this person in. Now, this other dilemma maybe is a little bit more gray. Let's see what you think. So this is about sensitive information. You are working late one night at the office to meet an important deadline. You accidentally delete an email your coworker Bob sent you with a file you need. Early today, you were working with Bob at his desk and you saw him log into his email. You noticed his password was really easy and you remember it. And now you're getting panicky. To make the deadline, you decide to log into Bob's computer and get the file. You happen to see in his inbox an email from a competitor that clearly shows Bob has a conflict of interest. Your company has a right to personal privacy policy. And just to make this a little thornier, the policy is considered very important to upper management as a way to foster trust. If you tell Bob or your boss, they will know you broke this policy when you logged onto Bob's computer. There would be no other way you could have seen that email. So, do you tell Bob? Do you tell your boss? And if you answered no to either of the questions, would it change if Bob was leading some negotiation on behalf of your company with the competitor? So go ahead and, Sarah, go ahead and put those questions out.
Yep, so the first one, so do you tell Bob? And I'll just leave this open for a couple more seconds here. Thanks for all your responsiveness. It's so great to hear where everyone lands. All right, so Sandy, it looks like 46% of folks said that they would, 54% said that they would not. Second part of that question is, do you tell your boss? So how do y'all respond to that, yes or no? So this one looks like 15% of folks said that they would tell their boss and 85% said that they would not. And then the last part of the question, let's see, would your answer change to yes? So would you tell your boss if Bob were leading some negotiations on behalf of your company with the competition? So for those of you who said no, would your answer change to yes if this was the case? And I'll just leave this open for a little bit longer. Alrighty. So it looks like 27% of the folks who said no originally said that their answer would change to yes in this situation. 55% said that their answer would not change. And then we had 18% say not applicable. Awesome. Thank you guys so much for your participation.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. That it is kind of enlightening, I guess, that in the first scenario it was a little bit more clear. It was a simple travel report and pretty much everybody said they'd go ahead and report that. In this case, it's a little stickier because you're involved in some way. You're not sitting necessarily on the moral high ground, so what do you do? It's the ethical questions obviously are not always just, you know, black white. That's not how things work, which is one reason why they're so difficult. So let's continue here. So in business, by business ethics, we're talking about ethics that actually lead to higher profits. This isn't, you know, altruism or something, or, you know, some religion. This is about just being fair, committed, honest, having integrity, being transparent, competency. These things build trust. If you have good business ethics, your customers will trust you. If your customers trust you, they'll come back, they'll recommend you, and you'll have more customers. More customers means higher profits. It's a good business model to have good ethics. Not to mention, it fosters a good work environment. Now, what about a lack of business ethics? Lack of business ethics leads you to lower or no profits. There are so many examples of this in the news. Now, I don't claim to know the actual facts around these cases because many of them are still being litigated. It takes years to get to the bottom of these. But there are situations in the news today where we have seen allegations of fraud that have ruined business or at least harm them. This one over there on the left, The Inventor, that's a documentary about Theranos, which is a blood testing company, where the CEO is accused of massive fraud. It ended the business. They're shut down. That's a single business that got ruined. With the Enron scandal of 2001, it led to the de facto dissolution of Arthur Andersen, one of the largest accountancy partnerships in the world. And you can see this little, I put this little joke there on the right-hand corner. I see from your resume, you spent 5 years with Arthur Andersen, and it's shredded. This harms even innocent workers who are affiliated with those companies. If the whole company goes down, you're sort of tainted with somebody else's fraud, perhaps. Now, the Roundup story is one I'm familiar with because this is one that is in part of my industry. The Monsanto is under fire that glyphosate, one of their main products, is actually it's Bayer Monsanto now, but that glyphosate is causing harm to people, to make it short. And they've been sued, and plaintiffs have won millions, in one case, billions of dollars of punitive damages. This, again, is still being litigated, and I make no claim about the truth of this, but Monsanto is dealing with a very old fraud case. This IBT lab that I spoke about at the start, they had created some data that Monsanto used back in the 70s. And those allegations that Monsanto had something to do with that IBT fraud is something they're litigating now still. What is this, 50, 40 years later? That's pretty amazing. Now, what happens in that type of situation is that people begin to lose trust. They don't trust the companies. They don't trust that the regulators know what they're doing. And you can see this even in the Austrian lawmakers have decided they're just going to ban glyphosate. They don't know if it's safe or not, which is really amazing considering how well studied it is, but nobody, this is what's happened. So other examples that seem to last forever, Dieselgate seems like it's forever with us. There's the opioid epidemic and accusations that the pharmaceutical companies knew what was going on there and hid its addictive nature. So lack of business ethics really is bad for business. So when are businesses most vulnerable? Well, generally speaking, a business is most vulnerable when it's under pressure. And today, lots of businesses are under pressure. About half the people on this call have undergone some kind of change, more than likely because of outside pressures on their business. There's lots of demand now for higher returns on investment. There's stiff global competition, fast market shifts, new economic drivers, and fast business cycles. So these pressures cause businesses to end up in mergers and acquisition situations, or maybe simply new strategies. And this creates a situation of pressure. So what happens if the pressure of change is left unchecked? Well, first of all, the pressure increases at all levels. It's not just the CEO or the guy in the ranks. It's at all levels. The employees at all levels fear that their job might go away. They feel betrayed because they've been working hard, And, you know, we all know how that feels if you're working hard and all of a sudden somebody says, well, that's not good enough. You're going to lose your job anyway. You feel betrayed. And this can foster an unhealthy competition. There are more opportunities in the company to commit fraud. And I'll explain that more later. And then people begin to rationalize that under all this pressure that it's okay. They have a moral justification is one way to rationalize. I need this job to support my family. That's actually a very common thing to think, and it sounds reasonable. You can displace responsibility. My boss told me to do it. It wasn't me, that's him. You can diffuse responsibility. Everyone was doing it, so why not? You can attribute blame to somebody else. The company deserves this. I'm being treated unfairly, doesn't matter. Or you can distort the consequences. Well, there's no harm here. Everything's safe. It doesn't matter if I just lie a little bit on this one piece of paper with deadlines on my back. So this creates what is known as the fraud triangle. This is what criminologist Donald Cressy describes as the fraud triangle. You've got pressure and opportunity, and then you must have rationalization. If you don't have rationalization, you won't have fraud. You'll just have pressure and opportunity. And again, I'll talk a little bit more about opportunity as we get further. So why do people rationalize? How does this happen? Well, we are only human. People are not robots. They operate inside a system of many complex influences. They have their core values, have their goals. How people behave and their preferences are very different one person to the next. There's the environment around them. And if the environment around them affects people one way, another person will feel very differently. For example, if you put an introvert and an extrovert in the same room, they're not experiencing the same thing because they're human. There's social environments and internal factors. So when people are under pressure in a change environment at work that is not well handled, there are many feelings that come about that are fairly universal. They'll be disappointed. They're lost their positioning in the company. They lose trust in their boss. They feel a lack of transparency. They don't know what's going on. They can tell people aren't telling them the truth. There's constant change. There's no clear path to the goal. These are factors that are very de-energizing. You feel rejected, you panic, you're overworked. On the other hand, energized workers are working in an environment, this is pretty universal to all people. If there's clarity, if they know what their purpose is, if they're participating in the change, if they are challenged but not too much, they're given adequate praise and reward, they're accepted, they can feel successful, they have free time for their family and loved ones. So nobody is immune to external influences. And if they get bad enough, you will rationalize as a defense mechanism. It's just part of being a human being. It's normal. So what happens if there's a fraud situation and somebody speaks up? So many studies have shown that whistleblowers are really not well treated. If you're in a situation where somebody is blowing the whistle, the other people in that company will be threatened. They are thinking perhaps he's going to get us all fired, or they may deny it. Like, I don't work for a bad company. He's got to be wrong. Actually, some whistleblowers are just retaliating. Like in the Salem witch hunts, very famous. Those people were lying. Or they may think, you know, I did that thing, but it's not so bad. I'm not a bad person. Or they may think, oh, let's just forget about it. So there's lots of these rationalizations that cause people to want the whistleblowers to be quiet, and they put on pressure. It's very common for whistleblowers to be considered mentally ill or narcissist, tattletale from, childhood days. This is what you call people who tattletale, get a life, you're taking things too seriously. They management may cause them to actively put pressure on, reassign them to terrible jobs. You know, here's your new office in the supply closet, or, oh, you're fired. So these are our mechanisms, it's subconscious maybe even, to sort of quiet the person who's saying the emperor has no clothes. And this is exactly why these internal control systems will fail when the pressure gets so intense. It's a lot to believe that somebody would just stand up and say, hey, this is wrong, and then, you know, you basically lost your entire career. That's not an easy choice to make. So is there a solution? Because this can really be a runaway train if it gets bad enough. And my position, and it's very, I'm not alone in this. This is, the research shows an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So what can we do to make this situation better? Or, we can let it get worse. Again, the outside pressures are there and you have to change. But if you let the change alone to just run its course, it will increase the pressure if the change is not managed well. If it's botched, it's non-transparent, and it doesn't value people. Change that is handled well, on the other hand, will avoid or relieve pressure if it's logical, transparent, and it values the staff. So you can manage the change to reduce the pressure. So what is change management? This is processes and programs that actively plan rather than react to the pressures of change. It started in the 1940s, the one of the first change management models had a three-step process. It's very simple: unfreeze, change, refreeze. Basically, okay, we're going to change, do the change, and then set the new norm. Nowadays, we have a little bit more nuanced model that takes into account the detail of change, and these are based on the theory U model of Otto Scharmer and Pete Segal. This theory U model is really focused on people, and it's been adapted and reformatted thousands of ways, and it's kind of the mainstream change management backbone. It focuses on the agility and participation across all parts of the organization, because change cannot happen just because you wrote it down on a piece of paper. People need to be involved in the change, or they won't understand it, they can't participate, and you're gonna end up with that pressure that is just really very damaging to the business. So change management has some very simple techniques that can work well. First of all, the goal needs to be defined clearly in concrete terms. A vague sort of nebulous goal will lead to a lot of confusion and it's unattainable. So leadership needs to be aligned on the goal. Again, you can't get alignment if you don't understand what the actual goal is. So it must be concrete and understandable. The goal also needs to be reasonable. So even if you set a stretch goal, if you're not listening to feedback, you're never going to have a reasonable goal. So you must listen to feedback to make sure that the goal is reasonable. You have to create buy-in in your staff, so that the new roles and responsibilities are understood, because role confusion is deadly. It just creates chaos. A clear and transparent goal tied intrinsically with business ethics is key. If there are no business ethics involved in the goal, you're really in trouble. So I want to just take a little time and talk about Enron, because it's been so well studied. Since it's been a while and the litigation's over now, and so people really know, or they have a good idea of what happened there. So Enron happened when there was the Enron scandal, I should say, happened because people think it happened because their financial gain was really the only goal. There was no other goal. There was a, the leader of Enron was the change from this man named Kipling to a man named Skilling. Now, Kipling was known as the doctor of discipline. He had instilled a very regimented business ethics and control management system. He was a, that worked very well. He used to tell his staff, I don't want us smoking our own dope. He didn't, he would have none of it if it was too much of a fluff discussion. And there were no issues when Kipling ran Enron. When it changed over to Jeff Skilling, he was referred to as a creative risk taker. He always wanted to push the envelope, the boundaries, to aggressively make more and more money. Well, and even though Enron had this really great code of ethics, it was circumvented by Jeff Skilling's leadership style and the culture that was created in the company. They would reward people, for example, who were telling how great things were and maybe not so fact-based. And the people who were fact-based and more kind of down-to-earth and maybe less risk-taking were essentially pushed out the door. Skilling sought high-end, very high-educated people, MBAs and so forth from very prestigious universities. Right out the door, you were more likely to be hired if you were smart, glib, extrovert, and he would try to mold you into a ruthless trader. So this is what has been said about how Skilling's management style was. Then when bonuses came around, they actually were so large to reward the ruthless traders that they had the car companies come to the headquarters and allow people to buy their car with their new bonus. And by car companies, I'm talking about, you know, high-end cars. These are Alfa Romeos and BMWs and Aston Martins. These were the like luxury cars. So the management controls were really circumvented by his actions and the culture that was created. And this is why business ethics, even though the goal might have been, we're going to follow this book and we're going to make a lot of money. The action was, we're really just going to go make money. And that was it. So this gets to be a problem. So what are some common pitfalls in change management? Well, in this scenario here, we have unrealistic goal and the leaders not aligned. So the CEO has described to his two senior managers, Bob and Pat, what the goal is. Now, they are not understanding the same goal. So Bob thinks, oh, yeah, I can do that. And he works with Sally and their staff, and they get done what they believe is the goal, and everybody over on that side looks pretty happy. And on Pat's team, he heard a different goal, and they think, okay, well, I'm gonna try to do that, but it doesn't really work, and they're getting very under pressure and stress because they're not doing it well. Now, HR is sitting out on the corner because they don't know what any of this is. They have not been told in detail or understand the business in detail enough to really understand what's going on. So they look at this and they think, wow, you know, Bob's doing a great job and Pat, maybe not so much because everybody over there looks really stressed out. So now we have unhealthy competition. That's the result of this little scenario here. The staff down on Chris's team are looking around and they're thinking, oh man, I'm not going to get a bonus because the guys on Sally's team, who I'm competing with, are doing great and we're doing terrible. So somebody on that team may decide, you know what, Chris doesn't know the goal. He just doesn't know. I'm going to go talk to Pat. And then they talk to Pat and they say, you know, I think Chris is messing up and this is why we're all stressed out. And Pat's thinking, you know, maybe this guy's right. Maybe Chris is messed up. So we've got some unhealthy competition here because people don't actually understand what the goal is. Now what happens? Pat gets rid of Chris and hires in Jake. So we got a new line manager. Now what happens? You've got still an unrealistic goal. The leaders are not aligned. And through no fault of his own, but Jake is a new guy. He is not able to give the type of oversight that you need in this change system. It's too complicated, this situation. So there's lack of oversight for his staff. And there's, at the end, the staff and his team really don't know what to do. So there's role confusion. And this really jacks up the pressure. Everybody on Pat's side is just thinking they're going to get fired. I mean, even Pat thinks they're going to get fired. Again, if you are going back to the we're all humans concept, this is an extremely stressful situation, particularly for, you know, depending on your personal drivers and your personal situation, to be faced with potentially losing your job because of poor change management is really a very, very unnecessary and a difficult situation that's so easily avoided. So to recap, that in change management, it is actually really critical that the goal is clearly defined and leadership needs to be aligned. That means anybody in the company who is in a leadership position needs to understand clearly what the goal is and align. All staff, including, you know, each other and upper leaders need to listen to feedback, and the goals have to be attainable. If the majority of the people think it's not attainable, then it's not. So avoiding role confusion is also critical because that just creates chaos. It expends energy and it's really damaging. It causes a lot of infighting and conflict, and it's not good. So, and again, don't forget that tying the goal to the business ethics is really very important. So in conclusion, today's business environments, fraud is reality. There are pressures from change that really create conditions that are ripe for fraud. When pressure can build at any level of the organization, it's very easy to say, oh, well, these companies are all fraudulent because of, you know, three guys in some dark office who decided to do that. No, it's a reality of human nature and we need to pay attention to it and understand that how to address it. So change management is a really good tool to relieve pressure, but it actually has to be done with care. So my last thoughts, one person can make a difference and everyone should try. I want to leave you this one thought. I was watching the news before I started this webinar and I was listening to two African-American voters talking about President Trump, and one was for him and the other against, and the guy that wanted, you know, would vote for him again was a conservative business guy. And he was saying, you know, he's good for the economy. I'm going to vote for him for that. And the older woman was a Democrat. She said, I will never vote for him because I would never put my values before profits. And of course, the young businessman felt, you know, ashamed of himself and started backpedaling. What I'm telling you is values, ethics are profitable. And it is good for business to stay on top of the business ethics and pay attention to ways that create problems, pressures that are just too great for any normal human to endure. So I don't know if we can take questions now or how does this work, Sarah, but that's the end of my talk.
Super. Thank you so much, Sandy. This was great and really interesting to listen to. So thanks for sharing this content with us. Yes, everyone, we do have some time for questions. So if you have any for Sandy, feel free to send those in using the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. We'll take just a few minutes to answer those questions. I will be sharing the recording of this webinar with everyone, as well as Sandy's contact information so that y'all can follow up with her and continue the conversation from today. I think there were some really interesting points touched on, so I'm sure there's room for further discussion. Sandy, any other issues or parting thoughts that you want to leave us with. We don't have any questions coming in, so if there are any kind of items you want to address or thoughts you want to leave us with, now's the time.
I would just say thank you very much for listening, and I hope you found it useful. I think that, like I said, it's a complex issue, but if people are paying attention, I think that's, you know, you've won most of the battle. So it's a current issue. I hope you found it useful, and thank you for your attention.
Yeah, thank you. A question that did come in your way. So what are the most challenging aspects of change management to implement from your viewpoint?
To implement, I think from my viewpoint, I think listening to feedback can be challenging because people are, you know, again, under pressure. And when people are under pressure, they have a hard time listening. So, and recognizing that this is at every level of the organization. So the line manager may have difficulty listening. The senior manager may have difficulty listening. So if you're in management, it's really important to stay calm and just see, is this person telling me, you know, the truth? This goal is unattainable, because unattainable goals are actually terrible. All these other things, you know, role confusion, other tools you can address by involving people, getting buy-in. It's hard to listen when you're stressed. I guess that's the biggest thing that I've seen.
Great, thank you. Another question for you, Sandy. Do you have a stellar example of a company's professional conduct and ethics policy, one that you've seen that is just really excellent? And besides providing this policy to new employees for signature upon they're starting at a company, should the policy be resent to employees on a regular basis?
To the first question, I don't know of a policy that I can point to that is, you know, necessarily better than another one. I know that the companies, some companies, you can look at their policy, like Enron, for example, and think it's fabulous, but it doesn't work. And I'm not honestly sure if resending it to employees helps. I think the most important thing that you can do in a company to make sure that it works is if it's recognized as part, like bound, intrinsic to the goal of the company. So when managers speak about, we want to make, you know, more profits, that's all great. But, you know, how? We want to make more profits by making a great, you know, product, whatever, product X, and then reward people who behave that way, that they make a great product X, because that's where the rubber hits the road, is are the managers rewarding that behavior? If the managers don't reward that behavior, you're having people sign policy, you know, compliance things doesn't really help that much. You may not get anywhere with that, honestly. That seems to have been the case at Enron, because they all signed off on that. You know, I guess, yeah, you know, yeah. I mean, it can't hurt it cannot hurt to retain people. You can't give lip service to it, is my point.
Yeah, that's great point. Well, thank you so much, Sandy. Everyone, I do encourage you to follow up with additional questions you have for Sandy outside of the webinar. Feel free to. Sandy, thank you again for being with us today and for sharing all of this with us. Great presentation, and we really enjoyed having you.
Okay. Well, thanks, everyone. Have a good afternoon.
Take care. Have a good afternoon. Bye-bye.
Bye.